Welcome to this demo lesson where you're going to get the chance to experiment with S3 event notifications and Lambda. Now you're going to use both of those technologies to implement a simple, event-driven, serverless image processing workflow. Now how this is going to work is we're going to configure S3 event notifications on an S3 bucket. And we're going to call this bucket the source bucket. Now when any images get uploaded to this S3 bucket, an event is going to be generated. That event will be passed through to a Lambda function which will be invoked. That Lambda function will gather all of the data contained within that event object. It will load the original image and it will process that image, in this case generating 5 different pixelated versions of that image and putting them into a processed bucket. Now we're going to implement this step by step so you'll get the chance to understand each of the individual components. Now attached to this lesson is a link which contains full text-based instructions for this demo. Also included will be any assets or anything else that you'll need as you move through the demo. Now to get started, we're going to need to be at our Aws console, so let's move across to that now. Okay, so now we're at the Aws console. Just make sure that you're logged into an Aws account with an IAM identity with admin permissions. And as always, make sure that you have the Northern Virginia region selected. Now the first thing that we're going to do is create the S3 buckets, which will store the source images and the processed images. So we're going to create 2 S3 buckets. So to get started, let's move to the S3 console. Now this will either be in recently visited, or you can type S3 in the search box at the top and then click to move to the S3 console. Now we're going to be creating a source and a processed bucket, and both of these are going to share the same base name. So you need to decide on a base name. In my case, I'm going to use the name Pixelator. So what we need to do is click on Create Bucket, and under bucket name, type your base name. And again, you need to choose something unique. So I'm going to use Pixelator as my base name. And then at the end of this, we'll put hyphen and then source. So this is the source bucket of the application. Now you can leave everything else as default. Make sure that you've got US East 1 selected under region, and then scroll to the bottom and create the bucket. Now, if you do get an error that the bucket name is already in use, then you need to choose a different base name for the bucket. So just to reiterate, this is the base name that I chose. You should pick something different. Next, we'll create a second bucket, and this is going to be the processed bucket for this application. So we'll use the same base name. So I'll click on Create Bucket. Again, I'll type Pixelator, and then hyphen, and then processed. And you should use your own base bucket name, and then just append hyphen processed onto the end. Again, choose US hyphen East hyphen 1 for the region, and you can leave everything else as default. Scroll down to the bottom, and click on Create Bucket. Okay, so now we've created both the source and processed buckets for the application. The next step is to move across to the IAM console to create the Lambda execution role. So that's what we'll do. You can go back to the main AWS console, and if you've used IAM before, it will be in the recently visited services, or you can type IAM in the search box at the top and then click to move to the IAM console. Once you're at the console, you'll need to click on roles, and we'll be creating a service role that a Lambda function can assume. So go ahead and create the role. Now we'll have to pick a trusted entity type, and it's going to be an AWS service. You should see Lambda listed under common use cases, or alternatively you can click on this drop down, scroll all the way down to the bottom, and it's listed there. But generally Lambda is a common use case. So select Lambda, and this is going to mean that the role that we create can be assumed by a Lambda function, and that's what we want. So go ahead and click on Next. Now we're not going to assign any permissions at this point because we're going to come back in the next step and create an inline policy. For now, just scroll down and click on Next. Under role name, call it Pixelator role. Verify that under the trusted entities, you can see lambda.amazonaws.com. If you can, everything's good. You can scroll down to the bottom and click on Create Role. And this has created Pixelator Role, which can be assumed by a Lambda function. Now, in the instructions for this demo lesson, I've also linked a policy document. So I want you to go ahead and open that policy document. So this is a JSON document which we're going to use to give permissions to anything which assumes this IAM role. So it's got some placeholders. It has replace me 4 times at the top and your account ID listed twice. What I want you to do is to copy this entire document into your clipboard and then move back to the IAM console. Once you're there, click on Pixelator Role. And then under permissions and then permissions policies, we're going to add permissions and it's going to be an inline policy. So we need to go ahead and create an inline policy. Now we're going to edit this directly using JSON. So open the JSON editor and delete whatever policy document is listed there already as a template and paste in your clipboard. Now don't be concerned if it lists errors at the bottom. We just need to update these placeholders. Now the first part of this that we're going to update is the resources under the S3 allow action. And this is going to allow our Lambda function to access both the source and the processed S3 buckets. Now there are 2 lines for each bucket, one which refers to the bucket itself and another which refers to any objects in that bucket. So we need to update both of those. Now if you do need a reminder of your bucket names, click in the search box at the top, type S3 and open that in a new tab. What we need to do is to get the base name for our buckets. In my case, it's Pixelator, but again, this will be unique to you. So just make sure that you select the base name of your bucket and copy that into your clipboard, and then go back to the IAM console. Select one of the replace me's in these ARNs for the S3 component and then just paste in what you just copied to your clipboard. So we're replacing the replace me placeholder with the base name of your bucket. And then we need to do that 3 more times. So in my case, we've got the Pixelator source bucket, objects inside the Pixelator source bucket, the Pixelator processed bucket, and then objects inside that bucket. Now the next thing that we need to update is the account ID placeholder of these second 2 statements. So these allow the Lambda function to create a log group and create log streams and put log events. And these are required in order that the Lambda function can log to CloudWatch logs. Now to get your specific account ID, click on the account dropdown at the top right, and it's this account ID that you need. Now this has got hyphens in. It's actually a 12-digit number and we don't need these hyphens. Now if you click on this icon next to the account ID, that copies this number into your clipboard and automatically removes these hyphens. So go ahead and click that button and then highlight the Your Account ID placeholder and paste in your real account number. Now again, this needs to be your account number rather than mine. So do the first one on the second statement here and then replace the second placeholder, so your account ID, with your real account number. And once you've done that, both of these errors should disappear, and then we're good to click on Review Policy. Now, in my case, I got an error. It appears that there's a leading space in this policy, so I'm going to scroll all the way up to the top. I can see it here, so I'm going to select the first curly brace, put my cursor right before that, and just press Delete to delete that first leading space. And once I've done that, I'll go ahead again and click on Review Policy to move forward in the process. Now under name, we're going to call this inline policy pixelator_access_inline. So go ahead and enter that and then click on create policy. And this means that when this IAM role is assumed by the Lambda function, every time it's invoked, it gets access to all the permissions that it needs to perform the task. So it can access the source bucket to load in the original image. It can access the CloudWatch logs to log out any status events. And then it can access the processed bucket to store the output. So that's everything that we need to do from an IAM role perspective. We've created the role and assigned it permissions so that when the Lambda function is invoked and assumes this role, it has access to all the permissions that it needs to perform the tasks. Now the next step is that we need to create the Lambda function. So this is the code for the Lambda function. This is the code which performs the pixelation process on an image that we upload to an S3 bucket. Now just to briefly step you through how this works, first we import a number of relatively standard Python modules. So these are available within the Lambda runtime environment. But we're also importing one called Pillow, known as PIL, and this is a library which allows Python to perform operations on images. Now, this isn't inside the standard Lambda runtime environment, and so we have a number of options. We can create our own Lambda layer which contains PIL. Alternatively, we can use a Lambda layer created by somebody else which contains these libraries, or we can create a Lambda deployment zip which we create containing these libraries, and we use this as we upload this code to Lambda. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to create our own deployment zip. So we need to provide these libraries for this function to run. Now before we do that, just at a really high level, this is what this code does. So first it reads an environment variable from the Lambda runtime environment called processed bucket. We have to provide it with the bucket to store the processed images. Then it uses the Boto3 libraries to connect to S3. It receives an event, because remember this is an event-driven workflow. So basically when an object is uploaded to the source bucket, an event is generated, and this event is passed into the Lambda function when the Lambda function is invoked. So Lambda is able to extract from that event the source bucket and the object name. So both of these are available to the Lambda function. Then what it does is it creates a temporary name for this object, so a random string. It sets the path to download the source image to inside the temp folder of the Lambda runtime environment. It then uses the Boto3 library to download that original object. And then it runs the pixelate function 5 times, generating 5 different versions of this image with various different sized pixels. Essentially, all this function does is to decrease the size of the image and then increase the size again, which causes it to become pixelated. We run this 5 times, and then again we use the Boto3 library to upload each of those 5 new pixelated objects to the processed bucket. So we need this code for our Lambda function to work, but equally we also need these additional libraries which don't come as part of the standard Lambda runtime environment for Python. Now at this stage you can either choose to create your own deployment zip, or you can use one that I've already created. If you're going to use the one that I've already created, then you can just watch the remainder of this set of instructions. If you do want to create your own deployment zip, which will be good experience for both the exam and the real world, then you should definitely follow along and do this in your own environment. Now I'm running on macOS, and so the instructions will work fine on that operating system. They should work fine on Linux, but if you are using Microsoft Windows, you'll need to vary the instructions because Windows uses different commands and utilities. Okay, so I'm going to go across to my command prompt, and the first thing that I'm going to do is create a folder called My Lambda Deployment. So I'm going to use mkdir and then my_lambda_deployment. Then I'm going to move into that folder, and I'm going to create a subfolder called Lambda, and then move into that Lambda folder. Now currently that folder's empty because we've just created it. Now into this folder, the first thing that we need to store is the function code itself. So this is lambda_function.py. So go ahead and save this entire code within a file called lambda_function.py in that folder. And I've included a link to this code attached to the instructions for this demo lesson. So now if I do a listing, I can see this file inside this folder, lambda_function.py. Now next we need to get those additional libraries for the imaging functions of Python. So how I'm going to do that, I've attached a link to this lesson of this website, so pypi.org, and this is the Python Package Index website, and this is where you can get downloads of any Python modules that you might need to use. So I'm going to get the module that we need to perform the imaging operations, and it's for Python version 3.9. So I'm going to go ahead and search for pillow, which is the name of this library. And we can see right at the top, Python Imaging Library Fork. So go ahead and open that. Now your version might be slightly different, and that's okay. The crucial part is for whatever version of pillow that you download, we need to get the version that matches the version of Python that we're using for the Lambda function. Now when I'm creating this demo, that's version 3.9. So I'm going to click on download files, and then I'm going to scroll down, and we've got it for different Python versions. So version 3.8, version 3.7, and so on. So I'm going to scroll down and I'm going to look for one for version 3.9. Now we can see for version 3.9 that we've got downloads for lots of different operating systems. Now the one that I'm looking for is for Python 3.9 for Linux and using the x86_64 architecture. So in my case, it's this one. Just make sure that it's the one that has CP39, not PP39. So it needs to be CP39. Once you've located that, go ahead and click on it and you'll be able to save that file. And you need to save it into the same folder that we've just been working in. So the Lambda folder inside my Lambda deployment. And now if I do a listing, I'll be able to see that I've got the Lambda function and then I've got this downloaded file which contains the pillow libraries. Now this is actually a zip compatible file, so I need to unzip this file into the current folder. And I'll do that using this command. So unzip and then the name of the file. And that will inflate that file into the current folder. And now if I just clear the screen and just do an ls, you'll be able to see we've got PIL, we've got this original download that we did, we've got the dist-info file, and then pillow.libs. And that's everything we need. So now I'm going to remove the file that I just downloaded, clear the screen, just do another listing, and what you should end up with is the lambda_function.py, pillow.libs, the pillow, then the version dist-info, and then the PIL folder. And that's everything that we need to create our .zip file to deploy into Lambda. Now, what we need to do now is create a zip file with the current working directory at the top level of that zip file. And we'll do that using this command under macOS. It's going to create the zip file one level up in the tree, so in the parent directory, and it's going to call it my-deployment-package. .zip, and it's going to zip the current working directory, which will include all of these files and folders. So I'll go ahead and run that command, and that will create the deployment zip. And then if I do cd space dot dot to move up one level and do an ls, we can see that we've created the my-deployment-package.zip file, and this is what we're going to be using to create our Lambda function. Okay, so this is the end of part one of this lesson. It was getting a little bit on the long side, and so I wanted to add a break. It's an opportunity just to take a rest or grab a coffee. Part two will be continuing immediately from the end of part one. So go ahead, complete the video, and when you're ready, join me in part two.